Today, our message is called Building an Altar, and I want to invite you, if you will, to open with me to the book of Genesis, chapter 12, Genesis, chapter 12, and I want to read to you a passage of scripture that summarizes what we want to look at today. Genesis, chapter 12, and I want to ask you to look with me at verses 7 and 8. Genesis 12, verse 7, and this is what the Bible says. And the Lord appeared unto Abram and said, unto thy seed will I give this land. And there builded he an altar unto the Lord who appeared unto him. Verse 8 says, and he removed from thence unto a mountain on the east of Bethel and pitched his tent, having Bethel on the west and Hion on the east. And there he builded an altar unto the Lord and called upon the name of the Lord. Today I want to talk to you about worship, but a very specific kind of worship. Back in the 70s, there was an exchange student program between Japan and the United States. And they had a Japanese student that came over to the U.S., and while she attended school, she actually lived with an American family. And so she ate the American food, she went to the American school, she even went to church. And after she was done with her year of spending this, you know, in this exchange program, they asked her, they said, what was your impression of America? And she said, you know, I was very impressed overall with the American lifestyle. She said, I was very impressed with the way that your families run. She said, I was very impressed with the way that you run your schools. She said, I was very interested in especially your churches. She said, I noticed that, you know, you have a weekly program. But she said, I'm curious. She said, I noticed that in your homes, I did not see any shrine dedicated to your gods. She said, in Japan, not only do we go to the temple, but in every home, there is a shrine dedicated to our God. Now, it's a sad fact, but the truth is that many people that come to church each week don't have family worship at home. And today I want to talk to you about family worship. Now, I have a statement from a book called Ministry of Healing, and I want to read this to you, because it summarizes very succinctly what the burden of this message is. And this is what it says. This is from Ministry of Healing, page 392. It says, in a sense, the father is the priest of the household, laying upon the family altar the morning and evening sacrifice. But the wife and children should unite in prayer and join in the song of praise. In the morning, before he leaves home for his daily labor, let the father gather his children about him and, bowing before God, commit them to the care of the Father in heaven. When the cares of the day are past, let the family unite in offering grateful prayer and raising the song of praise in acknowledgement of divine care during the day. Now, today, this is the summary of my message. And that is that in every home, God desires. Now, please understand, we should all individually have a devotional relationship with God. Can you say amen to that? What do I mean by that? I mean that individually, all of us should pray and we should read the Bible for our own selves. Okay, that's something that goes without saying. But what I want to share with you today is that as we are families, there is a special need for us to have a worship, corporate worship experience at home every day at a certain time of the day in order to commit our families to God for that day. I attend a gym close to my home, and I've been exercising. I try to exercise regularly. Some months I do better than others, but I try to make sure that I exercise regularly. And what I've learned is that when you see one of these, you know, well-developed physiques, when you see someone that has a lot of musculature and low body fat, what you see them doing in the gym is only part of what makes them look the way that they look. Does that make sense? In other words, when you see someone that looks very athletic, very healthy, very fit, what you see them doing is only actually one third of what it takes to look the way that they look. Because exercise is important, but if they're not eating right, no matter how much you exercise, there's a saying among gym goers, you cannot out-train a bad diet, okay? In other words, no matter how much you lift weights and how much you do cardio, if you have a bad diet, it won't matter because your bad diet will always win, okay? But the other thing that most people don't realize is that in order to have that appearance, not only do you have to exercise and have a good diet, you have to sleep a certain number of hours every night, because if you don't, your body will not recover and then you won't make any growth. Does that make sense? Now, in this Christian life, it's the same. When we come to church each Sabbath, what we see about each person is really only a small part of what makes them a Christian. Does that make sense? Coming to church is a great thing, and it's a necessary thing, but it's only a small part of what it takes to be a strong Christian, because in order to really be a faithful and strong, committed Christian, during the week, there are certain disciplines that you must have that leads to you being a strong and mature Christian. Does that make sense? And one of them is family worship. Now, when I think of the reasons why people don't have family worship, it's usually one of three things or a combination of them. When people don't have family worship, number one, it's usually because they can't fit it into their schedule. What do I mean? Lack of time. So here you have a father, he wakes up at 5:30 in the morning and he leaves for work. Well, maybe the kids don't go to school until 8 o'clock, right? So what happens? Somewhere in the way, we lose this opportunity to be able to have a corporate family worship. And I want to just say that I've learned, and I think many of you have learned this principle. We make time for the things that we think are important. Isn't that true? If you think it's important to eat breakfast in the morning, you will make time to eat breakfast in the morning. If you think it's important to exercise, no matter how busy your day is, you will make time to exercise. And so we only make time for those things that we think are important. When people say, I don't have family worship at home because we don't have enough time, part of that reason is because people don't prioritize the importance of having family worship. Now, I'm going to make a confession to you, and I'm doing this only because I want you to understand that pastors are people too. We're human. And when my wife and I first got married, we had worship every day, like as a family. So every day we had worship. And, you know, as a couple, when you're first starting out, it's a beautiful thing to pray together, to study the Bible together, to sing together. That's a beautiful thing. And, you know, we did it. But, and I'm not, you know, I'm not saying that there's an excuse, but somewhere along the way, it started slowing down. Like, it was erratic. It became like every other day or once every 2 days. And then soon it became just on the weekends. Like, on Sunday morning, we would have family worship, you know? And so, you know, yesterday as I was preparing this message, I said to my wife, you know, Eugenia, we gotta start having family worship because I have to preach about this. And my wife said, if I preach about this, she said, I'm not going to look at you during the sermon, you know. But I'm sharing this because, you know, we've just finished a prophecy series, and it's important for established members and new members to understand that in a family, in order to be a mature Christian, we need to have daily, regular worship together. Now, some people don't have family worship because their family members aren't interested. Let's say you have children and you have family worship and they're fidgeting and they're moving around. I want to say something about that. Parents have a duty to make family worship interesting. And I want to read this from a book called Testimonies for the Church. This is volume 7. This is from page 48. The father, or in his absence, the mother, should conduct the worship, selecting a portion of scripture that is interesting and easily understood. The service should be what? What does it say there on the screen? It should be short. And I'm going to make an appeal to our church here. When we pray in public, think of the children. Because some of them are not used to kneeling. And so we have counsel that public prayer should be short. Does that make sense? And I don't know if you've noticed, but because before I had children, I love to preach these like really ornate sermons with flowery words and long, you know. But after I had kids and I started realizing that kids' attention span is so short, it became very simple and very compact, okay? And parents, if you have children, the counsel is to make your worship short. I'm not going to set a time limit, but short is short. Does that make sense? And look, when a long chapter is read and a long prayer offered, the service is made what? Wearisome. And at its close, a sense of relief is felt. So this is not how to have family worship. Does that make sense? Make it interesting. Maybe you watch a YouTube video, you know, but make it something so that the kids are like, hey, when are we having worship again, you know? And so this allows the children to be interested in worshiping God. Does that make sense? So it starts at the home, and this is where we learn to have worship and how to worship. The third reason why people don't have family worship is because sometimes we have unforgiven sins in our lives. Have you ever had this experience? You've done something wrong and you haven't confessed it. And because you know that there is this thing between you and God, you're not eager to pray. You're not eager to study the Bible because your own heart condemns you. And I want to just challenge you that we need to make sure that our hearts are ready to meet God every day. Amen? And so I just want to challenge you, even if you don't have children, if you're just a couple, have worship together. If you're a family, if you have children, keep that worship service short. Make it interesting for the children. Make it fun. Now, there are three things that family worship should have. And I'm not saying this from my own wisdom. This is earlier from that statement that I shared with you. There should be songs of praise. And you don't have to be a musician. Today, online, there are so many resources. You can get music online. But make it a time to praise God in music. Number two, there should be some type of scripture reading. Now, I'm going to give you a clue. Pastors, we take a week to write a sermon. So every day, we don't write a sermon for our family worship. I use a book. It's called a devotional, okay? And if you don't have a devotional and you would like a free one, come and see me because I have a whole library and I will give it to you for free, like no cost attached, okay? I'll give it to you for free. But what I do, my wife and I do, is we'll sing and then we'll open the devotional and we'll read the reading for that day. It's very short, but usually there's something that is you can take with you after you're done reading it. Does that make sense? And then the third thing is you should have some kind of prayer. Doesn't mean everybody has to pray, but it's good that you pray together, okay? So a short prayer. And I want to leave just three things with you because I knew that this sermon would be short, but I wanted to make it memorable because this is something that I believe families need to practice together. Family worship should be short. It should be regular, meaning every day, try to pick a same time. And try to keep it sweet. Make it interesting. Make it delightful. Make it something that you can look forward to. And if you can do these things, then we can bring God into our homes. And when God is in our homes, then it's not going to be difficult to worship God at church. Amen? And so I want to challenge you, Westchester Church, and those of you joining us online, if it's not already, make family worship a part of your spiritual experience. Make this part of your spiritual journey. Don't just come each week, you know, to church, but have worship at home. I want to invite you to bow your heads with me as we have a word of prayer. Father in heaven, Lord, today, this message is probably a very simple message, but my prayer is that every member here today in their heart would make a decision, a commitment to begin to have, if they haven't already, to begin to have family worship every day. Lord, help us as church members, as Christians, to invite you into our homes. May we grow and mature spiritually because we are including those ingredients that help us to truly be mature Christians. We ask these things. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.